Good afternoon. Welcome. I'm Damian Wetzel, director of Aspen Institute's arts programs. It's a pleasure to welcome you here today. Good to have so many of you with us. We're going to start now and let the rest of the people get their lunch and filter in. But we wanted to get started. I'm going to leave the major introductions to our moderator today, so I'm going to spend the next 30 or 40 minutes introducing him, because that'll leave you enough time. That's good.
I don't think it's enough.
Dean Obeidallah, a comedy world luminary who hails from the rich comedic ground of the legal profession, which I learned actually is not uncommon.
It's true.
We can do a separate panel discussion on that at some point.
I'm there.
Dean and I met some years ago at an Aspen Institute conference in Oviedo, Spain, as he told me, where people go to discuss the value of cultural diplomacy, we learned. And since then, we've had parallel course in many ways, but it's a pleasure to welcome him back here to actually moderate this panel and to bring the unique sensibility that's led him to do things like co-create the Arab-American Comedy Festival in New York and to have his own serious radio show. Looking at many issues of the ways that comedy can influence our thinking, but especially, in my mind, take us aback to the point where we actually understand things to a much clearer level that breaks through barriers of understanding through humor. So, Dean, I'm going to turn it over to you. I want to welcome our guests, and I'm so grateful to you for joining us today. Dean, take it away.
Thank you very much. Have a nice round of applause for Dean. He did a nice job, man. He didn't get enough of Good afternoon, everyone. Assalamu alaikum. What's up? How are you guys doing? Thanks for coming out. I am Dean Obeidallah. I'm honored to be here. Our panel is How to Make White People Laugh. It's good there's a lot of you in the crowd. joking our way to a more tolerant future. I have the honor of introducing our two great panelists, both of our friends of mine. Oh, I get this one. Hi, Dean. Hi, Dean. There we are. Hi, I'm Dean Obeidallah. Welcome. Assalamu alaikum. Shalom. So today we're talking how to make white people laugh. And my good friend here, Negin Farsad, Iranian-American Muslim comedian, actor, writer, filmmaker. We made a comedy documentary together called The Muslims Are Coming. It's on iTunes, $3.99, pick it up. She's a TEDFellow, named by Huffington Post, one of the 50 funniest women in America. Her new movie just came out called Third Street Blackout, Janine Garofalo and Ed Weeks. And she also wrote the book that we're going to be talking about today, which is available for only $27.50. Outside, $27.50?
I don't know.
Haggle. You'll learn tonight how to haggle, so you can maybe bring that down to $25.50. Her book is How to Make White People Laugh. She shares a very funny and engaging personal experiences growing up as an other in an American culture, which is sometimes not that sympathetic or embracing of the other, frankly. We'll talk about that. And then over here is my friend, Imam Daayiee Abdullah, great guy. He's a president and founder of Mecca Institute, a Muslim think tank and online school. He's based in Washington, D.C. He's a scholar in Sharia sciences and Quranic interpretation, a former public interest lawyer. He's lectured nationally and internationally on progressive Muslim concepts, and he performs same-sex, opposite-sex, and interfaith marriages for Muslims. He's also America's only openly gay imam. In fact, he's only in a handful of openly gay imams in the whole world. So we have this great panel today, and we're talking. What we'll do, first talk a little bit about Negin's book and then have a group conversation. About 1 o'clock, we'll do Q&A. So get questions. Let's think about it. So Negin, first, your book is How to Make White People Laugh. What is the secret to making people with little melatonin laugh? What do you do for these people?
This guy. Okay.
That's so much better.
Oh, hello.
I'm going to go on a limb and think you might need a third mic.
Because you know, yeah.
Let's might want to get that one off.
We'll think ahead on that. We're comedians. So, like, even this thing was, I felt I wanted to grab it, but because we like to, we're comedians,
mic, yeah.
And then this is what happens. All right. So, what am I talking about?
White people.
Oh, yeah, white people. guys, I wrote a book called How to Make White People Laugh. It's available for some amount of money outside. One of the things I think, in making white people laugh, what are the reasons I called it that? Because I want it. My goal is to like lubricate white people because they control a lot of stuff. space and the economy, HBO's Game of Thrones, Tetherball. And so I think when you're in charge of that breadth of stuff, it's important to keep those people kind of well-lubed and laughing. And my feeling is that if we can get more white people laughing, they might start fewer wars. So that's like side goal with the book.
So your book is an opiate for white people.
To calm them down, chill them out. Yeah, I mean, honestly, like, I think we need a national kickboxing class or something to get rid of the rage, and then follow that up with some comedy. I think that'd be a good, you get out the aggression, and then you sit and you have a nice laugh. It makes you feel open. And the brand of stuff that I do, I like to call it social justice comedy. And there are a few basic rules for social justice comedy. One, it's not partisan, right? So this isn't about politics. This is about justice, and nobody is against justice.
Right.
It's inviting and warm, right? It makes you feel like you're sitting inside of a burrito, which is always really nice. Three, it's funny but sneaky. Like, you could be hearing a treatise on income inequality, but encased in a really sophisticated poop joke. That's kind of like the peak of social justice comedy, is when you can achieve those three things.
And look, just for the white people here, by 2040, they're going to be a minority. Do you have any pep talk for them? And to tell them, like, hey, it's going to be okay, white people. I'll have a few sequels out by then. Anything?
You can do a solo show, talk about your experience, write some poetry.
People might like you.
All the brown people do now, just to make it. I liked, there's a comedian that had a joke, and I can't remember her name, but anyways, New York-based comic, who would say, all I'm trying to do is get through the day without writing another poem. And I feel like that's what it's like being a minority, right? And so white people, like, there's just, like, a lot of beautiful sonnets in your future.
You got, at least you might get your own month to celebrate your heritage. How about that?
Yeah.
Or at least a week, like Whitey Week. This is my dream. All right, let's talk about, so social justice comedian, in a way, sounds like a very fun superhero. Like, you're really taking on, no, because you really are, you're taking on very difficult topics. I've known Negin for years through a comedy, really dealing with difficult issues, but through comedy. Do you think, like, with your book, you can potentially reach people who would never read an academic book on the same topic?
Yeah, I mean, that's the idea, because comedy is just more fun, you know what I mean? On a scale of like one to, on a scale of whatever, on a scale of brochure to comedy, like, the average person prefers comedy, right? By a round of applause, who in here prefers brochures? Okay, who
Very
in here prefers comedy?
Okay. Ah.
So,
a few people,
so that's the thing. And I'll give you a little example. We can kind of make this more bring in the current election cycle. Which is so fun. It's scary. And what I did was, so, I'd like to kind of take policies to their logical extreme, and really kind of see what they mean. And one of those was that we should ban Muslims or put them on a Muslim registry, from Donald Trump. And whatever, needless to say. Okay, anything hideous that happened, it was Donald Trump, or like it was Ted Cruz. Okay. And so what I did was I went into the streets of New York, and I conducted what I called the Bacon test. Because, if you want to ban Muslims, you got to know who the Muslims be. So I went on the streets of New York, conducted a Bacon test, and I asked people, like, are you Muslim? And they would be like, no. And I'd be like, prove it. And they'd have to eat from a pile of cold bacon. And then if they didn't eat the bacon, I'd be like, okay, well, you're clearly a Muslim, and you have to sign the Muslim registry, which looked like a bridal registry. It had, like, ornate writing and flowers on it. And sometimes vegans would be like, well, I'm, like, vegan, but I'm not going to eat the bacon, but I'm not Muslim. And I'd be like, you're Muslim to me, sign the registry, And so the idea, and this is a video I did with MoveOn.org and Upworthy, you could see it online for free. And it was, you know, and the point is to sort of show, like, okay, like, to take these actual policies to their logical extreme, and what they mean is a religious test. And, you know, we, first of all, there's just not enough money in the budget for the bacon required to have that kind of religious test. And then secondly, it's unconstitutional, just side note. And so, you know, so those are the kinds of things that I think it's more fun to hear that lesson, sure. You know, in a funny video like that.
Plus, turkey bacon's better for you. Just to put that out there, folks. Mm-hmm. Just trying to help. So let's talk, and then we're going to bring in Imam Abdullah right after this. In this, your book, I should call you Noodle, apparently, because when you were a kid in school, which is part of the challenge of growing up with a unique name like Negin, in school your teacher called you not Negin, but something else. And yeah. Can you explain that a little?
No, well, I mean, because, and this is part, because growing up I longed to be Mexican, and because I grew up in Southern California, and in 40% of my high school was Mexican or whatever. And so, and they had icons like Cesar Chavez, and they had ranchero music, and they had every restaurant in this town. And it was just like they had a really recognizable culture, and they were brown, right? And so I just longed to be like Mexican. Yeah. So there, okay, are you're one of those people. Okay. And so I longed to be Mexican. And then in school, and the naming is really where things got to me, because, you know, all of the white teachers could pronounce the names of the Mexican kids, you know, like they'd roll there, they'd be like Aurelia here, like Rodrigo here, you know, and they knew all of their names. And I was just like, oh, and they would be like, Megan, no, Negin. McGream, no, Negin. And then one time, this teacher I had literally said Noodle. She just said Noodle Farsad. Like, that was accept. And I was like, what? And then she laughed and laughed. She thought it was so hilarious that she said Noodle. And I was just like, that's not even the right stereotype. We're a rice-based people. But anyway. It was so true. And so it just, like, reinforced my desire to be Mexican, because I was like, oh, why can't I be like Consuela, or you know what I mean, like something that the teacher could pronounce. And then I grew up wanting to be Mexican, and then in college there were no Mexicans, because I went to school in upstate New York. What up, white upstate? And so there were no Mexicans there, and I was just sort of like, oh, like, and for a second I thought, I'm gonna try and be white, like, right. Like, what, maybe I could pass. It turns out there was just far too much Dave Matthews involved in, like, being white, and I couldn't, and there was, like, monogrammed backpacks and stuff like that. I couldn't do it. So, and also, like, whiteness is not, you don't get to opt in. I learned that as well. It's rewarded. So, and that's when my, like, black formation really began, because they were the recognizable minority group on campus. And, you know, again, like, it's not like I ever was confused that I was black or Mexican, but you know, it's just like, I was like, well, they're not my people, but close enough. And I think that's what a lot of hyphenated Americans do. They go, that'll do, you know? And so, so I started, like, you know, watching the Canada Black Cinema and getting really, you know, and protesting on black issues on campus, wielding protest signs, and then I ended up getting, you know, like most Iranian American Muslims, I ended up getting a master's degree in African American studies. And people would just be like, what are you doing? You know, like, because I was also very shockingly the only non-black person in the program. And this is at Columbia Ivy League drop.
Nice, like that.
And I would just be like, you know, they were like, don't you have, like, your own people? And I'd be like, what are you talking about? Like, I will fight for African American rights whenever and wherever. Like, I have the DVD box set of A Different World in my backpack. Like, I'm about to change my name to Tyler Perry Presents Negin Farsad. And I was really committed, and I am really committed still. And I'm also committed to Latino issues, and I'm also committed to just any kind of immigrant issue.
But they weren't challenging enough for you, so now you embrace the whole Muslim thing.
So then I had to go full Muzz.
Oh my God. So, like, well, Latinos and black, that's not hard enough. Let me add the Muslim thing. So let me bring in Imam Abdullah and have you both in this part here. What do you think? I'll ask you, Negin, first, and then we'll go to Imam Abdullah. What do you think the biggest misconception is about Muslims now in America?
I mean, because the only thing we really see, you know, whenever we see Muslims on television, it's like they're doing, you know, a mass prayer, and the prayer looks like a CrossFit workout, right? Like, it looks really intense. Or we see, like, dusty dudes in the desert wielding AK-47s, or we see, like, the shrouded lady wearing the black burqa, and you don't, you know, and she's floating. And you don't really see any competing imagery, which is something that we tried to do with the Muslims Are Coming, which is to say, let's create a new stereotype. Muslims aren't terrorists. They're hilarists. Stupid. But
it didn't catch on the way we hoped.
But you know that if you show anything other than Muslims are violent, I think you're doing something, you know, good for the community.
And Imam Abdullah, what do you think? Because you're dealing out there with people in our community and outside, the biggest misconception about Muslims now that you have to fight against.
Well, I think in terms of the... Thanks. I think in terms of how people perceive it, it's the continuation of the movie process in the 70s. Of course, it was always the Arab, the Saudi Arab, who was always the lascivious right. guy who was doing all these different things. Or the anti-Schwarzenegger person that he was going to blow up and kill and all of that. But when they started, when whites started becoming converting more so to becoming Muslim, then it sort of flipped again. So now you have this blonde, blue-eyed guy who's now the epitome of being the great Muslim. So it crossed that whole spectrum, but yet too often they forget about the people who have been Muslim for decades and decades here in America, black and Latino, and other Muslims who have come, or Muslims and Arabs who have come here over the decades. So what it's done is that now they have to, people, to make white people laugh again, is that it really is a potpourri of people who identify as being Muslim. But the thing is that the problem is that they think of this monolithic Islam. There's only one particular time when I educate people is that there are a system of Islams with an S on it that have come and have fallen out throughout history. And so when they look at it, they really have to look at the big picture or under the tent type of thing rather than just thinking it's only one group of people who are really identifying and leading the group.
And one more thing for you, Mom. So I've had you on my radio show. You talked about you worked in the civil rights struggle. You worked in the LGBT struggle. Are there lessons from that that we can use, people who are Muslim and also are our allies, in fighting against anti-Muslim bigotry?
Yes, I think so. One is that there has to be a sense of diversity and connectivity. Rather than uniformity, look for unity in different aspects. So people who are comedians should be honored. People who are not politicians, you know, school teachers are still important.
Sure.
The garbage guy is still important. Those type of things, but we cover so many spectrums. And I think what has happened overall from the academic perspective is that Edward Said, you know, was the person that she went to before his death, you know, over a decade ago. But then when you start looking at newer people, meaning the ones who are coming up now, they're much more activists. And I think now the spectrum is that, well, how do we identify these people? Because they don't dress like the other folks. They don't, you know, make identifiable things. But the thing is to see how open-minded that they are, that they're part of our mixing pot.
Okay, and Negin, you know, Imam Abdullah is the only openly gay imam. You have a whole chapter in your book entitled, "There, Iranians Have No Gaydar." Why do Iranians have no gaydar? Like, what is it, jammed by the Ayatollahs? Like, what has happened? Like, why is there no...
No, I mean, this is like... So, because growing up in Palm Springs... Palm Springs is one is this weird desert town. And it's one of the top five retirement communities in California. It's also, like, one of the top five gay cities. And so it's the kind of place where you'll see, like, people dancing to Lady Gaga while adjusting their catheters. Like, it's that kind of town. And so, everything I say is really dumb. Okay. And so growing up, like, I grew up in a really hardcore, like, senior citizen neighborhood. I was the only kid. And then surrounding my neighborhood of senior citizens was more senior citizens. So we just had a lot of, and I would just be playing on the streets as a kid, and then there would be like really like slow moving Cadillacs coming down the street, like at very threatening minimum speeds. And And so that's and but the other so the other funny thing about it was that there were a lot of gay senior citizens as well. So and I think mostly senior citizens. I can't recall ever seeing like a hot young gay man. And so a lot of our neighbors were gay, and my parents would just refer to them as roommates. They would be lifelong partners, and they always just said, "Oh, they are a nice roommate," you know. And I think that they did that because maybe they didn't know, but maybe they didn't want to be like, "Oh, they're gay," and then this is what gay means. Like they didn't want to explain it to me. And then also, I think calling them roommates made it easier for them to be, you know, we had really great relationships with our neighbors and to be friendly with them and not to have to invoke any kind of like peer pressured homophobia, right. Which I think is, you know, something I think at that time too, like a lot of people like aren't really homophobic, but they get this peer pressure to be homophobic. And so calling them roommates sort of like, did away with that. But also, just on a more formal institutional level, our former president, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, he said, Iran does not have gay people. I don't know who told you that. So he just literally thought there were no gay people in Iran. He really had no gaydar.
You think he really didn't think so? Do you think he really?
I mean.
He had no gaydar, or do you think it was like he was jamming? Like he didn't want to him, it was some kind of weakness of their country?
To like admit that they had, I mean, probably like right. But you know, when you say something yourself for so long, you really believe it, you know? I think he had gotten to that point where he convinced himself that we really don't have gay people here. He's probably totally gay himself.
He's the gay. He might move to Palm Springs.
Well, I can definitely add to that. I've done some international human rights work and have actually worked with several.
So is Ahmadinejad gay? Is that what you're saying?
No. Oh,
okay.
I'm just saying that.
I thought you were going to confirm it. I've met him and he's clearly gay.
You know, they do exist.
Okay.
Although they may not do parades, but they do. But they do exist, and I've helped several of them, particularly in Norway and in a couple other places, in Belgium, where they have gone to seek asylum and refugee status. And so they do exist from a variety, from transgender to, you know, your average lesbian gay person. And so they do exist. People need to recognize that they're everywhere. Everybody's everywhere.
Right.
And that the important thing is that they're the same as everybody else. Like you said, some of the best roommates that you could ever have. Right.
You know what's also really weird about Iran, though, is that you are not allowed to be gay, but you are allowed to have gender reassignment surgery. So, like, that's one of their weird compartmentalizations. And it's paid for by the government.
The government, yes.
So that's one of those weird things.
But one of the things that happens in terms of that is that the society, though, they knew the person as being whatever gender they were in the binary. And then what a lot of them do is they have to relocate to another part of the country so no one knows them. And if someone comes there and recognizes them, then it's another move. Yeah. So it's this social stigma, too, that still follows them, even though they've been able to make the medical change.
There was something that I earlier we talked about misconception. There was one that I wanted to bring up, is that I'm not sure how many people here are Muslim. I'm not going to ask your religious test here, so you can travel freely. I'm not going to ask. But I don't think most Americans are aware that the biggest component of the Muslim community in America is African-American. Did anybody see Roots the other day, the new Roots that's been airing? And it begins with Kunta Kinte is Muslim, the baby, and that's really based on the book, Alex Haley, mm-hmm. and that 15 to 20% of the original slaves in America were Muslim. So African Americans predated any immigrant Muslims in this country, yet this misconception is that we're somehow a new immigrant population. That's why they want to ban, you know, Sharia law, they want to ban Sharia law, which it's coming, folks, sorry. No, it's not coming. They call it foreign law now. So anything with Islamic is foreign, because to these guys on the right, Jesus was born in Iowa and like wrapped in an American flag and driven home in a pickup truck while Toby Keith played. But what do you say to people? Do you think it helps in our struggle, though, Imam Abdullah, to make the point that African Americans are the biggest component, they've been here, of our community now, and they've been here for generations and generations, predating the formation of the United States of America? Do you think that'll help, or is this just a game? This is just words, and the haters, that won't change them?
Well, to know the history is very important. Because once you know your history, you understand who you are. So for many African Americans and some cross mixtures with the native groups as well, it's important to know their history. But when it comes down to the modern thing, it's just something that is a footnote at the bottom of the, and all those foreign guys, and then we do have a few that came here before we even started, kind of thing. Really, the one of the issues I think is, in my youth, one of my elder brothers belonged to NOI, Nation of Islam, yeah. at the time back in the early 60s. And so at that time, it was the black radicals. You know, the black Muslims were this group, yet they were the ones who were building businesses. They were the ones who were helping maintain a community with a level of standards that were important. And so I think that one of the things, once you start, as I said again, once you know the history, you start to have some sense of pride in that what your background is. But that pride doesn't have to go in front of you pushing other people out of the way. But it's just something that you know when people make comments, you can correct them, you know, let them know this history and move forward.
Right, and the flip side is, Negin, your parents were immigrants. You were born here, though, right, Negin?
Yeah.
So you were here legally. And
just had to clarify.
Donald Trump made me ask that. It was a question here to Trump. No, but in your book, you have a chapter about the children of refugees are more patriotic, which is very interesting because I can't quantify it, but I know what you're saying. And as a child of an immigrant myself, my dad's Palestinian, my mom's Italian, that I know what you're saying. Like, there's a sense of pride. What did you mean by that in your chapter?
Well, I mean, so the dorky story example of this is that I went to a debate summer camp at Yale when I was after my junior year of high school, and I was president of the debate team and vice president of the theater club, so I was like a super nerd. And I was at this camp, and we in our dorm room, my roommate was this Indian American girl, and my best friend who was our hallmate was Romanian, an immigrant. She had immigrated a few years earlier, and so the three of us were this like posse, and we had talked about how in our rooms at home we each had an American flag, but we didn't have one there, and so we're like, oh, we should make one. So we stapled together a whole bunches of pieces of paper. Like, so they were, like, large. And then we drew with marker an American flag. And it was super hideous. Anyways, but we posted that in our dorm room. And I just, when I was writing this book, I was thinking back at that moment of, like, how interesting it was that an Indian-American, Iranian-American, and a Romanian immigrant went to such lengths to have an American flag in their dorm room. Didn't strike me as odd, considering all the other, you know, immigrants that I know, first-generation people that I know, were all sort of, like, absurdly American. You know, we're all sort of embarrassingly, like, really dorkily American in a, like, oh, my God, what are you doing on July 4th? Like, I have my, you know, American flag T-shirt on. Like, it's, like, really, you know, we hew very strongly to that kind of patriotic edge. And I think it's because our parents came to this country, because some of them came from war-torn situations, some of them came from whatever religious oppression, and suddenly they had this freedom, and suddenly they have these things and the ability to earn money and a better life. And I think that, you know, my parents were always like, you know, if you were in Iran, you wouldn't be able to do X, Y, or, you know, if you were in Iran, you wouldn't be able to go, you know, to do a mime show, because I did mime. And
that's one of the good things about Iran.
Miming is totally banned. It is like it's banned in the Islamic Republic. But you know, like they were always telling me, you know, pointing out stuff that I wouldn't be able to do if I was in Iran. And, you know, and I think a lot of immigrants' parents do that. Like, you know, are you kidding? Like, you get Halloween. Like, shut up. You're just, like, you won the lottery. You're in America. And I think for me personally, every time I went back to Iran, we were the only family that came out. So I have many, many aunts and uncles and cousins, just so many. And so I would compare myself to these dozens of family members, and I did have everything, and they had nothing, and they were poor, and they were struggling, and they are still struggling under a very oppressive regime that, you know, and they can't get ahead, and they can't get out, and they don't know, and a lot of them are going to die that way. And so I think that's a very very gives you a very, very strong appreciation for America in a way that, you know, when you're a white people, you might take it for granted.
It's interesting because I really think that, and I'm speculating, but I agree. I think that the fact that, you know, my father was an immigrant, my grandparents were, we appreciate so much of the opportunities in this country that other people take for granted. Maybe they don't. Maybe they've been here for 10 generations and they're like, wow, this is a great opportunity here. But it's unlikely they do because they don't know anything different. Like when I've gone to the Middle East, I'm like, when I leave New York City, I'm like, I got to get back to New York City.
Not to draw too fine a point on it, there are plenty of immigrants who are, you know, assholes, I'm sure, who are like, oh, I can't log on to my Instagram account or whatever thing that's like, traumatizing them that day. But I think on a larger, like, ideological level, those things definitely play into how we are.
I mean, one of the things that's such a oxymoron in a way is that as a black American living in the Middle East and the Far East and Southeast Asia, that you're an American, so you get a different sense of treatment. As soon as I cross over the border and get in, my passport stamped and I'm in here, then it's okay, hands behind your back, you know, that kind of thing. So it's such a drastic difference that's there that people outside of America see being American as being the epitome of everything, but yet they rarely get the real information. I think because of the internet now, they get better information, but prior, they've never thought of POCs having difficulties in America. So it's another thing that now that they see it, it's a very different framework in terms of how we do that. But it's really important that, as you say, you know, make life white people laugh, huh? That this part of the process, that this is what is really the framework we're working with. But being Muslim also adds to that,
sure,
another layer.
No, there are challenges, and both of you deal with haters, and there's no doubt about it. A little bit inside our community, but outside. Again, you have a whole chapter, the breaking down the anatomy of haters, from the voicemail hater, the drive-by hater, the email hater. Like, which is your favorite and why?
Okay, I have a couple of favorites. I mean, one of my favorites is the drive-by hater, and I think we've all experienced this where you're, where they're at a stoplight, they wait for the light to turn green, and as they drive off, they yell out of their car, like, get out, go back to your own country, or whatever horrible thing they're yelling. And we had a moment of this in The Muslims Are Coming, available on iTunes, and it, we were standing in front of a Mormon temple, and in the Mormon temple in Salt Lake City, holding up a sign that said, hug a Muslim. Probably over 100 Mormons waited in line to hug these two dirty
bastards.
They
were really nice.
And they were so, these were the warmest, these people, it was like a master class in hugging, the Mormons, okay?
Mm-hmm. And we think it was a recruitment plot.
And so we're doing this, yeah.
Mitt Romney hugged us three times.
Mitt Romney kept coming back into the line.
I'm like, you're Mitt Romney, stop hugging me.
I'm not going to vote for you, doesn't matter. That kept, and as we're doing this thing that was like, really bringing tears to our eyes. Like, it was so touching. Someone yelled out of their, was at the stoplight, waited for the light to turn green, yelled out of the car, go back to your own country. And like, anyways, I'm from California, but it was just one of those moments of like, we're hugging, what is the problem? Like, how could you even find a piece of rage over hugging? Like, it's such a lovely act. And so they're one of my, and the funny thing is too about the drive-by hater in its current formation is that back in the day they used to get out of their cars and then hate you to your face, you know, and they just don't make them like they used to, you know what I mean? Which is just like another sign of the decline in America. But my all-time favorite hate category is the swing hater. And swing haters are sister to the swing voter. They're like, they go from hating to not hating. They're really ideologically slutty. And they do it because they don't have enough information, right? And so I think it's our goal to convert those swing haters because they're the ones, you know, that can be won over if they're given the right tools.
And Imam Abdullah, just so people get a sense of the challenges, because being an openly gay imam and identifying as that poses certain challenges above being Muslim, above being African American, frankly. And when I posted on my Facebook wall, you've been on my radio show numerous times, when I posted America's openly gay imam, I've had friends who I thought were pretty progressive Muslims email me going, either some saying like, you shouldn't have a gay person on your show. That was really an exception. Those were Muslims not in the country. The ones in the country were like, I don't care he's gay. I don't care at all, but he shouldn't be identifying as an imam. What do you say to those people? Because you're helping Muslims in the LGBT community who are in need of help. You're doing beautiful work. And that's what the argument I make back to them. And some of them would be moved a little bit, understand. They go, well, you're right. There are people in our community who are in need, and they are gay, and who better than someone like you? But they'd rather just that you would just live your life in the closet, frankly. That's the sense I get. What do you do? How do you challenge that?
Well, with any group, years ago when I was in the black gay movement, that blacks would be like, well, it's okay that you're gay, but just don't talk about it. And so it's the same thinking, the same line of thinking, because they feel a sense of embarrassment, sometimes because people act so silly and stupid, and then other times when they actually recognize it, well, I do have a cousin, we don't talk about it, there's uncle so-and-so, or there's aunt so-and-so. So it's one, those types of things. But one of the issues that I find in the Muslim community is that when I do have an opportunity to have discussions with people, I emphasize that there are people out here who are requiring services. They're believers in the faith, and they need to have certain types of services. And from that very beginning 15 years ago, it was pretty much LGBT. But since that time, I've had a large number of interfaith marriages that people have come to me. We're talking opposite sex people have come to get married. You know, and a regular imam would not do it for them. But yet I'm willing to open up and do that for them. But I have high standards. This is what people don't understand. I have some really strict standards as to what I'll do when I do it. So one of the things that's been really important, and this is the other side of it, you know, the side of the coin, is that in the gay community, for years, I never met a gay Muslim. And now, more and more out there.
Right.
But that was one of the problems. So even here, years ago, if I walked down your Peace Street, which is one of the gay areas here, I didn't know why I was not being liked, so to speak. Because, you know, they have a religious service, mm-hmm. and I participate in that. So I'm not certain that they didn't like because I was Muslim, they didn't like because I'm a black male, you know, those kinds of things. And so I just say, well, if they're going to hate, they're going to hate anyway, but I got work to do. Excuse me, I'm moving on, that type of thing.
But it's not part of the book or anything, but to clarify one thing, because we have a great audience here. I hear this all the time. Oh, look, ISIS says they're going to kill gay people. That's part of your religion. Can you answer quickly, is that in the Quran, is that part of our faith, killing gay people?
No, it isn't. It's not. What it is it's a political move on their part in order to make certain that they validate themselves. Dr. Abul Fadl did a book on authority and authoritarian, saying that the Quran is authority. They read it for themselves, and they become an authoritarian to do what they decide is important. So that's what they do.
I actually wrote about something ISIS did in the list of barbarity, but idiocy as well. I'm not making this up. ISIS banned people from wearing skinny jeans in the land they control. And that's not for women. They forced women to cover up. It was for other men because some ISIS guys were getting distracted by other guys wearing skinny jeans. Mm-hmm. They're like, look, I want to fight the Houthi war, but Bassam is beautiful. I cannot look at him. You must cover him up. I cannot watch this. I'm not kidding. They literally did that to ban men because the guys in ISIS were having little feelings that were a little uncomfortable to them at the time. So, you know, we've joked about Sharia law, but Islamic law is never coming to America. Even if we wanted to, we're 1% of the country. We don't want Islamic law. But there are places in this country where people are pushing Christian Sharia law, not far from here. North Carolina, Mississippi, mm-hmm. Oklahoma just tried to make it a felony to have an abortion, even in the case of rape, but the governor didn't sign it, thankfully. But Mississippi, North Carolina, with allowing to be discrimination against gay people. I've had you on my radio show to talk about that.
Yes.
How do we make, it's so funny that the same people pushing this Christian Sharia law are the ones accusing us of wanting Islamic Sharia law, which we don't want at all,
right.
But they do. How do we counter that stuff? Because it's such a battle that I'm dealing with all the time.
Well, I'm not certain if we're going to be able to battle it from a religious perspective because
right.
people are going to believe what they want to believe. But when we look at the aftermath, we look at the issues of the secular laws and how that enforces and also influences everybody, I think that's where it's going to be we're not going to go beyond this because I've faced this before. People of color, throughout, they face this issue of non-voting, blah, 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 those issues, housing discrimination, those things, and they know that secular law is there for protection. Mm-hmm. So I think this is one of the reasons they've had such a major pushback in terms of that. But then there's also the hidden things that was in the North Carolina law, like the way in which they stopped people from being able to file discrimination suits at state level and things like that. So to make them keep them economically poor has been part of the process, was the undercurrent, why they use the trans flag thing as being the thing. Look at all of this, but under here we're going to do all this.
So Negin, by the way, like, do you think growing up, in retrospect, you look back, do you think it was challenging being a young Muslim woman as opposed to today's world? Do you think today's climate would be more challenging?
Oh, that was, I don't know. That's a hard question because, you know, I was a baby during the Iran hostage crisis and my brother was in middle school. And so he had it really rough and we were living in the sticks of Virginia and it was like, really, he would get beaten up and but whatever just for being Iranian. So during the hostage crisis, I think it was really, and for those first kind of few years of the 80s, it was really tough for Iranians. And part of the reason my parents left and then I ended up growing up in Palm Springs is because Virginia was such an unwelcoming place for them.
It was that bad? They actually moved?
Yeah, it was really bad. I mean, the early 80s. It was during the Iran hostage crisis. Iran was in the news all the time, and everyone hated Iran.
It's gotten much better now. People love Iran now. It's just going great. I wish I could come back Iranian. Is that impossible? I can be reincarnated?
I think by the time I was, like, aware of things, like, you know, we started enriching uranium or maybe enriching uranium. We were like 5 minutes from enriching uranium. We're like, oh my God, in 2 weeks they'll enrich uranium. So that's kind of what I grew up with, is like the axis of evil stuff and the uranium enrichment constantly. What was your question?
I don't know. just filling time to the Q&A, that's all. This is a question I've been asked a lot, you've been asked it too. But in recent times, have you been contacted by anyone moved by your comedy or about your work and says, you know what, it really has made a difference? That's what we get all the time, like, oh, you're telling jokes is funny. Has anyone changed their mind? And it's hard because you can't quantify it, but every now and then you get a nice email from someone.
Well, it's funny too because people ask a question like, you know, the two of us sued the MTA, which is like the New York City subway system, over the right to put up funny Muslim posters. And we won, by the
federal
way.
Court.
For anyone else in court. Here sue a major state agency and win? No?
Put up funny posters?
We did. we did this lawsuit, and I think around that time, you know, people kept, and this was about 144 posters going up in 140 subway stations in New York City. This was not about changing, you know, this was not going to change anyone's life, really. People were like, why are you going through all of this? You know, why are you doing this? Do you think a poster? Let me give you a couple of examples of what those posters said. One of them said, for example, facts about Muslims. Fact, Muslims invented the concept of a hospital. Fact, grown-up Muslims can do more push-ups than baby Muslims. Fact, Muslims invented Justin Timberlake. And then another favorite was the ugly truth about Muslims. They have great frittata recipes. So this is the kind of, like, comedy that was on display in these posters. And you know, when people asked, why are you going through all of this? Do you think a poster is going to change anything? And my answer to that is, like, no, I'm not crazy and delusional. I don't think.
No.
Sorry, Dean. One poster is not going to change anything. But here's the ridiculous and rather cheesy way I view things, which is that, you know, we ended up getting those posters up, and in my mind, there was like a dude who looked at a poster and had a giggle, and then another person looked at another one and chuckled. And then if you add up all those chuckles, and I'm talking millions, once you get to the million mark of chuckles, that amounts to some kind of cultural shift, and that matters, you know? But removing the opportunity to have any chuckles would you don't get anything done. So no, I don't think one poster changes the world. No, I don't think the Muslims are coming, you know, radically shifted people's views. But I do think that there is an incremental shift. I get emails. I get the strangest emails, like, that you would never. I get it. I remember one of the first emails I got was from a 16-year-old Filipino-American girl in Iowa who saw the Muslims are coming and felt, like, connected to me and felt like we were telling her story. And I'm not Filipino, you know, but she felt that connection. I got an email from a 45-year-old white dude in Michigan who was a part of the armed services and had spent some time in Afghanistan and in the early part of the war or something. And anyway, and he talked about, you know, how he really hated Muslims when he went into his service and then kind of started to question it after he came back and question it more, and then saw our movie at just the right time to kind of get him over the hurdle. And those are...
Now he's an imam. He's running. No, he's not.
But, yeah, so I feel like, you know, those things happen, and it's really rewarding.
True. Any little thing can do it. You move... We'll do Q&A, but to paraphrase something by Robert Kennedy, I always like, he said, few of us can actually write change the world ourselves. I'm paraphrasing slightly. But all of us together collectively can write the story of our generation. And everyone, even if you just retweet something that is about social justice, you're making a difference. If you tell your friends, if you correct someone who says something bigoted, you're making a difference in the arc of the universe and how things move out there. So Negin and the Imam are very happy here. We'll do some Q&A. If anyone has questions, and it's judgment-free. Like, we're at Aspen Institute. You guys are educated, smart people. But even if you have a question about a Muslim, which I do my radio show every week, it's judgment-free because we all believe in having honest conversations, the only way to cut through misconceptions or stereotypes, or just a comment about comedy, about the book, if you saw our movie, or anything about joining Islam. We're here for that. No, we're not. It's not a recruitment drive. But you get a free book if you join. Negin? No, I didn't tell her. That was my thing. So no, you don't get the book. So anyone have a question or answer or comment? Yes, way back there, sir.
and actually, that comment was meant about was the start of a comment about being PC in a crowd. Here in Washington, we have the Unity Walk where people of all different faiths come together for 9/11, and the thought of having a comedy aspect of that. I wonder how that would go over and how that would goes with, you know, just the thought of PC, you know, like that comment that I just made, you know, wonderful sense of hummus. Someone might say, oh, that's disparaging. Another person might say, oh, well, not all Muslims eat hummus.
Right,
you know,
exactly.
Or whatever. So that's my question, and so I wanted to learn
about
the
PC scold
aspect.
You for saying hummus. No, I mean, we live in a world where there's a lot of instant outrage over certain things.
Yeah.
And, you know, comedy can play a role in bringing people together. If people go in with the right sensibility, the idea that there's going to be some things in the comedy that someone might get offended, but if someone's not intentionally demonizing, we have to have some latitude with comedy, or even in conversations today, not to get into it, but the rise of Trump is tied somehow to this world of stifling discussions, and we didn't know beneath the surface what lurked. Now we're getting a sense of what lurks beneath the surface. So I think we have to have honest conversation, but my whole test has always been, if someone's intentionally demonizing, they deserve everything they get, every kind of pushback. They're being playful, and it wasn't hateful, and we are adults. We know the difference. We have to have some latitude, at least as comedians. I'm always supporting comedians, defending comedians. Unless they're being a bigot on purpose, they deserve the hate. But
I mean, yeah, I feel really exhausted by the climate that we're in because, you know, so I have this joke that I used to do where I would say, you know, my mom, is a touch racist. She would tell me, she would say, like, for example, she'd call me up and tell me about her new accountant. She'd be like, Negin, he is Indian, but that is okay because with money, he is like a Jew. And so, sort of like double insult compliment. I don't know what that is. But anyway, and I remember doing that bit, like, I think I was in Minneapolis, and someone came up to me afterwards, and they were like, you know, like, that's really anti-Semitic. And I was like, wait, me? I'm anti-Semitic? You know, and they're like, yeah, I was really offended. And I was like, wait, but did you not? I mean, I'm making a commentary on the thing that she, and that, you know, and so there's some people that are just never going to, like, understand, like, they're tone deaf to humor. And that's really frustrating. But also, I mean, I think, you know, one of the most brave things that I've encountered is when we have traveled in the South and people ask us questions, you know, like we had people asking us questions like, what do you think of 9/11? Or, you know, why don't Muslims denounce terrorism? Now, if we wanted to get offended by that, it'd be easy. What do you think of 9/11 is a very offensive question generally. But I think it was really brave to ask it because it's a question that a lot of people have. Like, what does a Muslim think of 9/11? And they're too afraid to ask. So you really have to create an environment in which they feel like it's okay to ask any question you might have, because all of the rhetoric that has been dished to some parts of the United States is from Fox News and talk radio, and that's all they hear. So why wouldn't they have that question? It's a legitimate question for them. And I would hate for us to get so overly sensitive in this country that we can't even hear, because it doesn't help me for that person to sugarcoat what they think. I need to hear exactly what they think and know exactly what we're working with, you know? And so I think that's been, you know, the kind of PC sensitivity policing has been a disservice to that.
I'd just like to add that I think one of the things that happens is that there's a certain level of expectation that people have. And so when they talk to you, quite often you have to sort of take a few seconds to let the question go through to see, now, are you responding from an emotional trigger, or are you really going to answer their question in a way that they can understand it from their perspective? And I think quite often when you take that few seconds to do so, in the end, you see the head nodding, you see the smile, those kinds of things. So you know you're connecting with them on a level, even though it's just on that small piece, they still see the humanness between that's connecting us. And I think that's one of the most important aspects, that although we don't like certain types of human beings, you know, but we can still see the humanness in them. And I think that's when you've made that connection. If you keep talking, there's going to be something else that's going to connect to something else. And when you leave the conversation, quite often, you leave as people who've gotten some answers taken care of, and now you're willing to go out and talk to other people about things without the same sense of absence or distance.
Hi, Mac Odell. Just two questions. One, did John Stewart changed the world? And the second question is, okay, what about Charlie Hebdo and the Danish cartoonists who were trying to make humor that didn't, that caused a lot of, well, you know what happened.
I think John Stewart had an impact on the world. That's he was in our documentary, The Muslims Are Coming. He made time to be in it. I think comedians at their best, the famous ones, can raise awareness about issues and show you a different side to it. And if it goes well, inform you and entertain you at the same time. That's the highest form of comedy in my mind, political comedies. Informing, entertaining, you learn something. Charlie Hebdo and the Danish cartoon. The Danish cartoonist, I know what happened to him. I don't know all the facts that led up to that. But Charlie Hebdo I'm much more familiar with. There's nothing, and maybe we'll have the imams speak to that as well. There's nothing in our faith that says you kill someone for drawing the Prophet Muhammad. That's not part of our faith. That should not be part of our faith. Negin and myself have defended the drawings of any cartoons of Prophet Muhammad. Do whatever you want. Prophet Muhammad doesn't need your defense. I mean, that's the reality. That's the world we live in. But there are going to be people who, for their own agenda, either they believe it religiously or have a political motivation, and they're going to kill someone in a spectacle to make a political point, which to me was more Charlie Hebdo, because I'm more familiar with that. I mean, the guys had printed the cartoon years ago. And all of a sudden, Al-Qaeda is going to go kill these guys, because the reality was ISIS was getting a lot of press, and Al-Qaeda wanted some more press. So that plays a role into it. But maybe have the imams speak to the idea of the cartoons and any kind of religious prohibition, actually calling for death of someone for drawing the Prophet Muhammad.
Well, responding to that is that throughout Islamic history, and I always take people back to the history, there has been artwork. There's been work, I'd probably say, once Islam entered into Persia, since that time there have always been depictions of who the Prophet was. Usually you will see certain types of things like a halo around the head or the fire over the face or something. There are depictions. Not all of them give facial features, but there have been pictorial depictions. And so for them to make that statement shows the lack of knowledge they have of their own faith. So it always turns into the political usage of it there. But I'm a lover of political cartoons. Tom Tolles is one of my favorite cartoonists, and I love his thing. And Mike down in the Atlantic for the Atlantic, Mike Kovalevich, I think. But I mean, these are political cartoonists who just do wonderful jobs. And I think once we start looking at the cartoons to bring us back to our human nature, how we're interconnected, I think we can see some of those things. But as Dean said, it really was done from a political perspective, that they wanted to have something to be angry about and then to take it out on a society to show how big and bad that they are. We're the big bad wolf, you know.
Yeah.
I have a question for Imam Abdullah. Recalling as I do that Alexander the Great legendarily got on his knees and cried because he had no worlds left to conquer, I wonder, as a gay black Muslim, you ever despair at running out of discriminated groups to belong to?
That's a great question. No. One of the things I find so unique is that, and this is what I was talking about earlier about the level of expectation. There have been times when I went to Georgetown and did my undergrad in Chinese and Arabic language and literatures. And so when I go places, I walk in and there's this black guy, and all of a sudden I'm speaking Mandarin to all the people there, and not only the Chinese are shocked, but the other people are shocked as well. And I've been in some places where the Chinese parents are talking to the son or the daughter saying, like, look, this foreign guy, he speaks better than you do. Why haven't you done such, such, such? So I can't get away. But no, actually, one of the things I find really important is that once I'm able to show that I have things more than just watching Beyonce, okay, or being able to do other types of things, then it brings us, blends us together. It shows that we have some sense of connectedness. And I'm a kid of the civil rights movement. And so the idea is that, like Steven Weinberg, I think, says that we have to be able to get people to start talking and doing things, because if we get the folks not doing anything, what's happening with Donald Trump is going to really hurt this country. It's going to hurt what we believe in and hurt how we interact with each other. And I don't think we need to go back to the 40s when there were race riots and things of this nature. I'm not super afraid of that, but I can see that it has that potential. And I just think that if we start thinking more clearly about these things and that our differences doesn't mean it's bad. And once we can accept that fact, difference has a goodness to it, then I think we're going to wind up making a major leap forward for a lot of people.
On the positive side, though, if Trump does get elected, it's just more material.
Yes.
It is, and then at the same time, I just hit my tooth on this microphone. You're welcome. At the same time, it's like he is his own punchline. Like, so it's hard to add to anything that he does because he's already such a showman, you know? The terror, I think, of having him trumps any of the juice that would come out of the comedic material. Because then also we'd be deported or something, maybe. I don't know. I would definitely. But, yeah, so I don't know.
The only upside to Trump winning is that my fiancé's in-laws can't visit because they're Muslim. They'd be stuck. It's the only silver line. Oh, they're really good people.
Dean is going to be single after today.
They're really good people. That's just a joke. So, anyone else have a question, a comment? Oh, right there. He's pointing for you.
This is more of a comment than a question.
Sure.
But you mentioned the PC police and all this is going on, and I think what's most important is that you have an understanding and be able to straddle two different worlds. And I think, Negin, you were so great because you talked about the making of the American flag at camp, but you referred to Ahmadinejad as our president. When you were talking, so I think the fact that you can talk about both of those worlds is a way that people who aren't a part of both worlds can hear more and really learn more from the type of things that you're saying, whether it's comedy or anything else.
I think. Well, thank you for saying that. And one of the things that people say to me whenever you know, I perform around the country, and also said while we were making The Muslims Are Coming is, you know, why do you have to call yourself Iranian American? Why can't you call yourself American American? And I think, you know, and I remember in one particular instance, the guy that was talking to me was like, you know, 10th generation Dutch American or something like that. And he is so far removed from what his Dutch roots are that it doesn't, you know, the urgency with which I say Iranian American, like the sincerity that with which I identify that way, doesn't ring true for him because he's so far removed. And I think, you know, I said to him, like, I grew up in the United States, and I love, you know, like, I love this country. But I also, for 18 years, lived with my parents. We spoke not one but two other languages, neither of which were English at home. And we, you know, and I ate different foods, and I had a different religion, and everything at home was different. And you're asking me to just wholesale erase that. That's, you know, that's like asking someone who's a Patriots fan to stop being a Patriots fan because they moved out of Boston. Like, why? Why? Mm-hmm. You know, go ahead. Stay a Patriots fan. I get it. And so I think that's the thing that we kind of that we kind of have to remind people is, like, there's that, you know, these people have that linkage, and it hasn't been erased for them yet. So hopefully you can be okay with that.
Two questions. Hi, is this on? Okay. So, thinking about hyphenated Americans, so then give me the name. How would you hyphenate the country's name? And then I want to know if at the end you're all giving hugs.
What do you mean the country's name? Do you? Like Iranian American?
I'm first generation. I'm trying to say that if you want to identify all of the, you know, all of the peoples here, then how would we change the name of our country? So I believe, I am Italian-American, but I'm American, and I think, for me, I'll never lose my interest in my heritage, and that's so imperative for everyone. But we are American. English should be our national language, and I'm not being hardcore about it. It's just that the mm-hmm. national identity is as important as our heritage, our personal heritage, but we all must come together, and not everyone is going to like each other. There's just, it's just a reality, a fact of human nature. You study history and you see we have never become really enlightened. That is solely an individual requirement, I believe, in my, as I get ready to die, because I'm an older lady, woman, but I feel the you know, we as individuals must take that responsibility to enlighten our own consciousness. So I just ask, because everyone is pushing, you know, for this and this and this, then how do we change the name of the country?
Well, I'll take it first. I don't think you have to change the name. I think the United States of America is a great name. And I think that the founding fathers, from the slogan on the Great Seal, you guys know the slogan is on the Great Seal of the United States, E Pluribus Unum. E Pluribus Unum, from many one. That was the idea of this nation. From looking around this room, all different colors, backgrounds, together we are Americans. You might be Italian-American. You might be Arab. I'm half Italian, so I'm half Italian-American, Palestinian-American. I'm American, though. I'm proudly American. But it doesn't make me less or more American because of my ethnicity. So I think United States of America is the greatest name based on what our founding fathers wanted. And again, going back to being appreciating that I'm an immigrant, I'm so glad, I am so appreciative that my father and my grandparents picked this country for me to grow up in. Because my life would have been much more challenging in Sicily or in the West Bank, frankly. I have more opportunity, more freedom. So I like the name. I think it's perfect. I think it fits.
Yeah, I don't want to change any of that. I mean, I do. I don't want to make America great again in the Trumpian sense. I do want to make America like the utopia that is in my head of what it could be. But that doesn't involve, you know, fundamentally changing anything in terms of, like, the country's name or the political structure. I mean, you know, and the founding fathers got a lot of things wrong, like, you know, slavery, but the E Pluribus Unum, I think they got right. And you know, and I also, like, long for the day that we can view a lot of different immigrant groups the way that Irish and Italian immigrant groups are viewed now, as just like, yeah, Irish background, American, you know, and that's kind of like how I would love for people to kind of see, you know, Iranian Americans or, you know, Palestinian Americans. Right. And yeah, and it was definitely a rocky start for both of those groups, like in a very like trying history. I think it's gotten, you know, to the point where we're like, oh, Americans. I think there's a utopia in my head, and hopefully we'll all get there.
I have to be the odd guy out in this particular situation, with odd, quote unquote. But in terms that the black experience in America has been very different, and so one of the things is that though, you know, enslavement is one of those issues, we are not that, we are a term out, but it's the way in which the legal system has been established that causes the major problems. Because it doesn't matter, as Richard Pryor would say, what do you call a black man or woman with a PhD? A nigger with a PhD. And that still rides here, but yet most younger people, and I'm so happy to say that, a lot of younger people, that's not true. And that's a wonderful thing to see in my 62 years of living, to have known what segregation was in education, though I was born the same year that Brown v. Board of Education changed the law. By the time I was in elementary school, schools were still, you know, there was white flight and schools were still segregated. And now today, I can see a very diverse and different group of people. The melting pot or the real mixture of salad is really true. And so that image, as you're talking about, is coming forward. But will it happen in my lifetime? I don't think so, unless I live until I be 150 years old. But, you know, I'll be the old imam that does that. But anyway, the thing is that I think we're really seeing a change. And we should be very open and glad that this change is coming about. And I really am supporting all of the young people. So if the old guys are so-and-so, send us all to the nursing home, please.
Well, here's what happens. I mean, parts of my family have been in this country, you know, like since with the Indians. And what happens is, I'm part Scottish, I'm part French, I'm part Italian, I'm part German. You can't keep track of it, and you just become an American. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that is precisely what you were speaking to, and that is what eventually is going to happen. It's a melting pot, but it often takes generations, as you've been referring to. But we all become one, and I think it works that way at its best.
And then maybe we'll all look... I was saying this on your radio show that, like, if you ever go to Brazil, everyone there was like, you can't tell, super ethnically ambiguous and all really hot. So I think that we'll all be like an extremely attractive country at the end of this.
Yes.
I have a different perspective because when I introduce myself, they'll ask me what country I'm from. And when I say I'm from Colorado, the centennial state, who got statehood in 1876, the centennial state, right? They'll say, well, why are you brown? Well, they're low information, and they don't know that half of the United States once belonged to Mexico, and then the conquistadores came in. Hence, we have San Francisco, Los Angeles. So when people say, you have a Spanish last name, and you are brown, what about your parents? Well, they were born after 1876. So I still, with a lot of pride, identify myself as Mexican-American or Hispanic. Mm-hmm. And I'm very proud of that. I'm not proud of the fact, well, I was a great assimilator because my parents said, if you speak Spanish or Italiano, you're going to get hit. So when I go for interviews these days and they say, habla español. No, I'm a great assimilator. And that's what happened in the 50s and 60s. You assimilated. And you tried to become American. But people stopped you and said, you're not a real American because you're brown. And you have a Spanish last name. But I say, what about Los Angeles? This happened to me right when Obama was running for president. my neighbors saw Latinos for Obama and said, girl, all this time we thought you were an American. And you're taking away good jobs from Americans. I said, I work at the Department of State, God forbid. We have 50 states, and Colorado is one of them. And the Southwest, whether you like it or not, was once Mexico. And we're not only gardeners and housekeepers and domestics. I'm proud to say that the judge that will be viewing the case on the class action suit for Trump University is Hispanic, American.
Yes.
Thank you.
I just. Judge Gonzalo Curiel, is that how you pronounce his last name? Curiel? That's the name of the judge. I just wrote about it for CNN, because I write for CNN every week. I wrote about it yesterday, about him calling him a Mexican. Just, I don't even have to say. There's not even words. what can you say? So, anyone else have a question or comment before we wrap?
You're talking about Americans, but you were sort of Indian. I was confused because I think of that as American Indian. Then I realized you meant East Indian. But how do you feel that about the country? This is, we're taking it. We took it from the Native Americans, and we're all here.
Right.
So it's a little bit of a. You're not acknowledging that we're kind of on somebody else's land.
I mean. You do.
Yeah. No, I mean, and I think, like, you know, I talk about that in my book, and I also talk about how, you know, when you're a minority, like, any fight is your fight, you know. So I feel just as passionately for, you know, for what has happened to the Native Americans as I do for what has happened to Black Americans, and fighting for, so we're all, it's all multiple sides of the same coin. So so you're absolutely right, and that should, you know, definitely be a larger part of the conversation. The sad reality is that the numbers have dwindled so much that it's hard to keep them a stronger part of the conversation, I think, on the national scale. And so we have to do, like, a better job at that.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we want to thank you very much. The Aspen Institute wants to thank you very much. We want to thank them for inviting us. How about one more round of applause for Negin Farsad and Imam Abdullah. Negin's book is outside. She'll sign. Will you sign it? Negin will sign the book outside. You can meet Negin.
And if you have any friends and you enjoyed what you saw here tonight, I'm going to be at Politics and Prose tonight doing some stand-up and some signing and whatever. So send your friends. It'll be real fun. And, thank you guys so much. Thank you to Aspen Institute. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, Dean, for moderating.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.